Hi everybody. Today we will continue analyzing the energy levels and also the rules in the transitions between the energies. And also Hund's rule we will see, and also the magnetic quantum numbers, Pauli's exclusion principle, and the rules for the energy transitions and the spectral terms. By using spectral terms, Zeeman effect and anomalous or anti-Zeeman effect, we will investigate. Okay, so this will be also the repeat of the previous lecture. All right, so in quantum mechanics, according to Bohr's theory, the angular momentum of an electron in an orbit was given by the multiples of h-bar. So L is just a quantum number. L is the angular momentum quantum number. So Bohr said that if there is a angular momentum of an electron moving around a nucleus, okay, it means that it has a specific angular momentum. And of course, because of this angular, because of this charge moving around, okay, with velocity v, using right-hand rule, we see that the angular momentum is given in the perpendicular direction to the plane of rotation. Okay, L is this way. Also, when the electron is moving around the loop, just like the current moving around the wire, okay, of course in opposite direction, the electron is also moving around its own orbit. So it will have a spin, in other words. The spin will be either up or down, okay? The spin. So in this case, there will be some kind of magnetic angular momentum, or spin angular momentum, and it will be given by just SH. It's also the multiples of H bar, which happens to be the Planck constant divided by 2 pi. In this case, there is a distinction between L and S because all S's are just 1/2. There is no other S. So the spin can be either up or down. Of course, this is the magnitude, and the spin up or down, okay, will be given by the vector properties of these spins. So here L will change from 0 to 1, 2, and n minus 1. Okay, so angular momentum quantum number, spin quantum number. These are L and S. So last time we have seen that for 3 electrons, atom, we have, what are the total spins, okay? What is the total spin number? Total spin number. So it means that we will have 3 electrons, but each one of them has spins 1/2, so that when you add them up, 1/2, 1/2, and 1/2, the result is S equals 3/2. So the resulting spin vector is this much. And also, okay, the another configuration we can have is that 2 of them will be in the same direction, but 1 of them in opposite direction, so that when you add them up, these two will cancel each other, and then we will end up with S equals 1/2. So that there are 2 possibilities. So for 3 electron atoms, the total spin can be either 3/2 or 1/2. So, but for electrons, but for 4 electrons, the maximum configuration will be found by just adding them up when they are in the same direction. It means that, as you see in this orbit, there are 2 electrons, but put 2 more. Of course, they have to be aligned such that they have the maximum distances from each other. So, one of them has this spin and the other has this one. The other, that one and that one, right? So these are the directions of the spins of these four electrons. In this case, all of them can be in the same direction, okay? In other words, when the spin is in this direction, okay, it means that the charges of the electrons are moving in this direction, okay? Or the electron is moving in that direction, provided that the charges are fixed on its surface. But actually, we really don't know the exact shape of the electron because we cannot really visual electron by any kind of microscope, because even one photon that you send to visualize this electron will give some kind of uncertainty in its position according to the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. In this case, we will not be able to find out, we will not be able to visualize what kind of things we are dealing with. Okay, so if, because the electron behaves like a wave, even you can send one photon will give some kind of position uncertainty so that we will not be able to catch the exact view of the electron, which is impossible. So that's why this is the reason that we cannot really see this the shape of the electron with our own eyes. There is no way that this will be happening in the future also. All right, so if four of these electrons are in the same direction, one half, one half, one half, and one half, when you add them up, you just see that the total spin is just two. And the minimum configuration, so this maximum, the minimum configuration is possible when two of them are in the same direction and two of them are in opposite direction, so that there is a full cancellation and S will be equal to two. Since this is the minimum configuration between the two, there is also one more configuration which gives you S equals one. Obviously, if you want to draw this, it's this way. So only one of them is opposite to the other three, so that S will be equal to one. So that the possible S values that this four electron atom can have will be 0, 1, and 2. Okay? So don't forget, when S equals 1 half, the spin magnetic moment, the spin angular momentum will be just 1 half h bar. So it's either plus or minus. Of course, it's the magnitude. You're not showing the vector sign. So since we have shown the angular momentum quantum number and spin quantum number, okay, spin quantum number, there is also another quantum number which gives you the summation of these two, so that J will be just equal to L plus S, of course, in vector notation. When you write this in the summation, then you have to consider the relative directions of these two vectors. So this will be total angular momentum quantum number. Okay. So basically, the total angular momentum of this atomic system is due to these electrons moving around in the orbit, so that the total angular momentum, of course, the angular momentum of each one of these electrons will contribute to the total angular momentum, just like they contribute to the total spin angular momentum. All right. So in this case, when L equals one, okay, what are the possible values of J? Okay, when L equals one. So in this case, when L equals one, for one electron, so this is for one electron, we know that S can be one half or minus one half. In other words, you can have L and S together, because since they are asking J, with J is L plus S, we L value should be given in order to find the possible values of J, because we know what S is, either one half or minus one half. So it's very simple. Since J is one, it's just a vector which has length one, and okay, this L equals one. So the half of this is just S equals one half, so that the total J, which is the sum of these two, gives you three halves. So this would be the maximum configuration. So it means that the electron not only moving in this direction, angular momentum is upward, but also the spin is such that it's in the same direction. All right, so J is 3/2. So this is the maximum case. The minimum case is when the spin is exactly opposite to the angular momentum of 1. Okay, in this case, 1 minus 1/2 will give you just 1/2. And as you see, this is the minimum configuration, and these are the possible values of J, which is 1/2 and 3/2. So there are two values. So actually, remember that we said that the spin momentum is SH and the angular momentum is just LH. These are according to Bohr's theory. Okay, but in wave mechanics, okay, this is Bohr's theory, which gives us a very good indication of simplicity in all the calculations. But whenever we have S, actually in wave mechanics, it's given by square root of S times S plus 1, okay, times H bar. And the angular momentum actually is given by the square root of L and L plus 1. H bar, multiples of H bar. These are also some kind of numbers. Of course, not integers, but some real numbers, because the square roots are being taken. All right. So so in this case, since J equals L plus S, the total J is also the total L and total S. So what are the total L and total S's? So the total L is just the sum of all I equals 1 to n, okay, n, or just the atomic number, let's say, Li vector, and S, the capital S, is the sum of all the spins, okay, spin vectors, from 1 to the atomic number. Whatever the atomic number is, it will give us the number of electrons, obviously. So you have to consider all the electrons, spin, and all the electrons' angular momentum, so that you can get the capital values of L and S, which happen to be the total angular momentum number and total spin quantum number. And then you multiply these values by H bar, and then you get the angular momentum and also spin angular orbital angular momentum and spin angular momentum. Okay, so these are all the possibilities. So in wave mechanics, we will see that sometimes in Bohr's theory, we will have like S square and L square and so on, or J square. Instead of this, in wave mechanics, we will replace these values by SS plus 1 and LL square by LL plus 1 and J square by J plus 1. In this case, when we do this simple analysis according to Bohr's theory, all we have to do is just change these values into these numbers, right? These, okay, instead of these ones, you consider these ones, and you are successfully applying the methods in the wave mechanics. So there is one interesting phenomenon. Okay, one interesting phenomenon: when L is less than, when L is greater than 1, okay, when L equals 2, for instance, and when S equals 1, okay, then the maximum J, okay, maximum J, S equals 1 means that this is the two electronic case, and each one of them has the same spin, right? So this is the case. So this is what we have to consider. So when L equals 2 and S equals 1, the total J is 3, and then the minimum configuration obviously is J equals 1, and then the other one will be, of course, J equals 2, which gives you this kind of configuration. Okay, so we will have three possible values of J. Okay, so Now, this is okay. When the atom is free and the electrons are just moving around and there is no external effect, these are all the things happening. But when we insert this atom in the magnetic field, say in some arbitrary direction, then things change, of course. So all these electrons will just instantaneously, okay, change their positions and also the directions of the rotation and rotational planes and behave differently. Because now there is an external effect and the atom will just give feedback to these external effects. Of course, when the atom is totally free, right? Usually this is the case in vacuum regions. So now what happens is that when external B field is applied, why not electric field but the magnetic field? Because we have magnetization, and because of this magnetization, okay, because of this magnetization, the charge is moving around, and then there is a magnetic field created, obviously. So when the electron is moving around the orbit, okay, around its orbit, in this case, some kind of magnetic fields are created because of this charge motion, right? So if the electron is moving this way, by using right hand rule in opposite direction, we will see that these are the magnetic fields due to electrons. Okay, so it's like the dipole, you know. So we know that the electrons, the magnetic field vectors, when they start from some position, they always follow the space and come back to their original position. So it's always in the shapes of loops. So the magnetic field lines will always come to wherever they are produced. So it turns out that just like the current passing through in this wire in this opposite direction to the direction of these electrons, okay, the magnetic field is created, and this creates some kind of magnetic moment. And this magnetic moment is just given by, okay, the area times the current, okay, the current. Of course, the direction of the current. It's like we can assume that this is some kind of a current, right? So we did some analysis and we said that the magnetic moment is given by using Bohr's theory. The magnetic moment of this electron moving around is given by mu b times L. So this is called Bohr's magneton. Okay, Bohr's magneton. And it has a specific value. Mu b is EH over 4 pi mc, okay? And then it has just some kind of value, a constant value. And in this case, the angular momentum in vector notation, the magnetic moment of this electron, angular moment is given by minus mu b times L. As you see, the magnetic moment is always opposite to the angular momentum. So if the angular momentum is this way for this electron, then magnetic moment is totally in the opposite direction. So this is some observation that we have done. So in this case, what happens is that when we have a magnetic field and we have this system, all of a sudden this electron's orbit will do the precision motion. Okay, it's not going to be just moving around like that. So it will be the orbit will change. Okay, will change its position. So we can draw this as this. So this is original direction, but when we have magnetic field applied to this original direction with an angle theta, maybe this angle. So this original orbit will just rotate around this orbit will rotate around the magnetic field like this. Okay, so if we place the magnetic field in a center, we will just draw a cone, and then we will see that this original path will just rotate, and then it will be either this one or that one. So there will be some kind of precision depending on the rotation around the magnetic field. In this case, what happens is that when we have just this magnetic moment vector, okay, this magnetic moment vector here will interact with the magnetic field. So now what happens is that if there will be a sudden energy change, because earlier the atomic system or the electrons were moving in this direction, but when the magnetic field is applied and their configuration just changed, in this case there is an energy change, right? Energy jump. There is an energy jump. Probably this new energy is smaller than the previous energy. This is how the nature behaves. The atoms always react the external effect by minimizing the their energies. So delta E will be given by the change in the energy is just minus mu L times B, okay, dot B. As you see here, the change in the energy depends not only the independent values of the applied magnetic field magnitude and also the angular momentum of this orbit, or angular momentum of these electrons, just one or a few, okay, and also the angle between the two, okay. So angle between the two. So this delta E, which is the energy change, is given by minus mu L, okay, times B times cosine theta. But mu L was, remember that according to Bohr's theory, of course, Bohr magneton times L, and then put cosine theta here and then write B there, and then give this a new name, which is ML. ML is the electron magnetic moment quantum number. ML, magnetic moment, okay, quantum number. So we will see that later on ML will change from minus L to zero and then plus L. So whatever L values, ML will change between the two. The reason is that cosine theta can have the maximum values plus one or minus one, and of course in the middle zero when the two vector is 90 degrees. So in this case, we will see that whenever there is a magnetic field, there will be some external energy levels created automatically. And the reason that this is precision, right? Precision motion is due to this torque, and the torque is given by just mu L cross B, okay? So their dot product gives you the total energy change with a minus sign, of course. The reason that we have a minus sign is, by the way, to get the new energy to be smaller than the previous one, basically. Because this delta E is E final, right, minus E initial. In order initial energy to be greater than final, this must be negative, because we have the second one, which is negative. So basically, this is greater than that one. It shows that the final energy configuration is smaller. So the electrons were just moving happily in this direction, but whenever there is a magnetic field applied, they change their position and they start to move around the magnetic field, not only in specific orbit like that. This orbit, which is in the direction of the magnetic field, is not, so this L vector will not be aligned exactly by L, but it will rotate around B, right? So L vector will rotate around B, so that this this orbit will be just do the precision motion. Okay, so when we have this property, we will see that because of this energy change, because of this magnetic field, there will be some kind of different energy levels when the magnetic field is applied. This is Zeeman effect, right? Zeeman effect. Zeeman effect tells you that whenever we have energy level like this, doesn't matter what kind of energy level it is, it's true for all kinds of energy levels. So when B equals zero, it's just a single energy level. But when B is applied, when B is applied, then this energy level is just degenerating into three different energy levels. One is up, the other is down, and this is exactly in the same direction. Okay, we can draw it like that. So this, why do we have this? Because here, suppose that this L equals one case. When L equals one, this level, of course, each level has different L values and different S values, whatever. So I'm just drawing this for L equals one. When L equals one, ML changes between minus one, zero and one. So that here ML will be equal to one, here ML will be equal to zero in the same energy level, but here ML will be equal to minus one. So that now this delta E that we just derived here will be this much delta E, and this much will be delta E. Okay, so whatever original energy is, let's say E star, this suppose that E star plus one and this is E star minus one, the energy levels will be given by E star plus delta E or E star minus delta E, depending on this configuration. Okay, so we said that. Now we introduced a new magnetic momentum orbital axial quantum number. This is axial magnetic moment axial quantum number, because it's multiplied by cosine theta axial quantum number, and ML changes between these values, while MS will be just plus one half and minus one half. Okay, and MJ, which happens to be the total quantum number, is just the sum of the two. Okay, so we will use this not very often though. Okay, so basically in wave mechanics again, we will have all these quantum numbers possible. So we said that actually where do these quantum numbers come into the play? Actually, what happens is that we will see later on that the wave mechanics, according to the wave quantum mechanics, okay, suppose that we are solving the Schrödinger equation, and the wave function for that will be given by some kind of radial function and some kind of angular momentum, L, or just as a function of theta, and maybe S as a function of phi. So it's going to be solved in spherical geometry by introducing three variables which are independent from each other. This is the way to solve some differential equations. This method doesn't work for all the differential equations, but for the Schrödinger equation in spherical geometry it works. So this shows you different radius of these electrons around nucleus. So this R1 and R2, right, this are related to some kind of quantum numbers. We will see that. Okay, so it will be N1 and N2. So the reason that we will have these kind of quantum numbers appearing in the solution of these differential equations is that the separation of variables requires that the differential equation is equal to some kind of constant. And these constants are given by some kind of magnetic, or some kind of quantum numbers, in other words. So these angular momentum quantum numbers are like, some kind of constant numbers, and they will move from L1, L equals 1, 2, 3, and all these numbers, and n equals 0, 1, 2, 3, okay? So these will be just showing you different radii of these electrons around the nucleus. So these quantum numbers, but these L will show you just the angular momentum in the theta direction, and phi will be just showing you that just one half plus or minus one half, it will show just the different directions of the electron spin. Okay, so as you see, the electron when it's moving around this, it will produce some kind of angular momentum given by this kind of function, and then when the electron is moving around its own orbit, the spin will be also produced, and there is an interaction between this angular momentum and the spin, and the total interaction will be given by the total angular momentum of the electron, which is given by L plus S. Okay, so now we can really find out the angular momentum, and we can use the regular conservation of angular momentum in when there is a reaction, for instance, between the two electrons and so on. So we said that by using these quantum numbers, we can just draw some kind of groups, and we can say that this is N and this is L, and ML we can put this is a magnetic axial quantum number, and M is the spin quantum number. And by using this, we saw that when n equals 1, L can have two values, okay, depending on different values of the spin, okay? So plus and minus, and L, of course, is 0 in this case. When L is 0, ML is 0. But when n equals, so this shell is totally closed. So this is 1s2, okay, because there are two electrons. The number of electrons is 2, as you see. And the angular momentum quantum numbers are going to be 0, and the spin quantum numbers will be plus and minus 1/2. Okay, so when n equals 2, we saw that there are 6 possible different cases, okay? 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, 2, okay? So what are they? Because for n equals 2, which is this orbit, we say that L equals 1. So for each electrons moving around the second orbit, L should be 1, right? So we will put 6 ones. The reason that we put 6 ones is because ML will change from minus L to L, including 0, so that each one of them will have minus 1, 0, and 1. We write this twice because each one of them will correspond to the spins of minus 1/2, plus 1/2, and so on. So basically, this group gives you the total 6 electrons, right? 6 electrons. So since it's 6 and n equals 2, so we just say that this is 2p6, okay? P means S, P, D, F, these are the values of, okay, L equals 0 corresponds to S, and 1 corresponds to P, and 2 corresponds to D, and 3 corresponds to F. So we have L equals 1, so that it's P, the quantum number is 2, right? And the number of electrons is 6. Here, the quantum number is 1. Okay, and we have L equals 0, which is S, and then there are 2 electrons. So 1s2, 2p6. And the other one has now the angular momentum quantum numbers, okay, are all 3s, okay? But because we have now possibility of having this angular momentum quantum number to be 0 and 1 and 2, because L goes to, okay, L goes to 0, 1, and the maximum number is n minus 1, okay? So whatever n value is, you have to get the maximum of L, which is 1 minus maximum n. So basically, L in this case will change from 0, 1, and 2. So 0, there is only 2 possibilities. And then 1, 6, just like this case, 1, 2, 3, okay, 6, and then 2, many of them. So in each one of those, because ML changes, for 0, we know that ML are 0 and then spins minus 1 half and 1 half, just like previous case. This is subgroup, by the way. And then when L equals 1, we will have the magnetic magnetic moment axial quantum number to change from minus 1, 0, and 1, so that minus 1, minus 1, 0, 0, and 1, 1. And for 2, of course, many of these terms, but we will just see that there are 6 electrons here, so that this is when L equals 0, we have S again, and then number of electrons is 2, and quantum number is 3, so we get 3s2 here. We will get 3p6 because there will be 6 electrons and the quantum number is 3, and p is when L equals 1. Obviously, for each cases, for this one, we have L equals 1. And the other one is 3d, of course, 10. There are 10 terms. So by using these notation, we can just fill all the orbits. Okay, so this is the shell, right? This is shell number 1. This is L shell, or this is K shell. So the whole shell, and this is now when n equals 2, this is L shell. When n equals 3, it's M shell. And we have subgroups. And these subgroups are called orbitals. So these are all subgroups. Subgroup, and this is also subgroup. Each one of these subgroups are called orbitals, okay? But orbitals, they don't mean the orbits. Orbitals and orbits are different. So basically, when we have this kind of configuration, we see that they follow each other, and there is, of course, some kind of energy levels of these ones. And the levels of energy levels of n L value, okay, and L number of electrons, which is numbered like this kind of notation, this is just a quantum mechanical notation, depends on Hund's rule. Okay, Hund's rule. And also Hund's rule, the energy transition for a closed loop or closed shell. It means n equals 1, n equals 2, and n equals 3, and so on. In this case, the total ML will give you 0, the total, the spin quantum number will give you 0, and the total L will give you 0. Obviously, it's obvious here, right? Because if you look at ML and LS, but these are vectors, by the way. The third one is vector. So if you just add these MLs in each groups, you see that there is a full cancellation if you just add them up. So this is 0 minus 1 half plus 1 half is 0. And similarly, the sum of all these MS and ML in each shell will give you 0. So this will give you 0, this will give you 0. Okay. But vectorally, the sum of these vectors will give you 0, okay? This is not easy to show here, but it's the case. So this is very important. These are very important. And Hund's rule is very important because it says that in each subgroup, it means this one or that one, or this one, So these are all subgroups or orbitals. Or orbitals. The most stable. Stable. Electron distribution. According to Pauli's exclusion principle, is when we have maximum multiple number. This is number one. Number two is for a multiple number, okay, the highest L value corresponds to minimum energy level. What is that? It's this notation. So L, J, and this is 2s plus 1. So this is called a spectral term. So the people who deal with spectroscopy are familiar to this notation, and this is called spectral term. And this exponent on the left, written on the left, is called multiple term. This multiple term depends on the total spin number plus one, two times total spin number plus one, and J is the total magnetic quantum number, including L plus S, okay, J, and L is just the orbital angular momentum quantum number. So this total quantum number, orbital angular momentum quantum number, and this is the spin quantum number, two times spin quantum number plus one. So spectral term is always given by this. And so please do not mix this one with that one. This is just the notation that we use in just the distribution of these electrons onto the orbitals and also the shells. But this is more important because remember that we had these energy levels that can be degenerated or whatever. So these energy levels are given according to these kind of spectral terms. We will see that. Okay? We will see these spectral terms. So Hund's rule says that if we have, for instance, if we have 3p, suppose we have 3p, okay, and 2p and 1p, as you see, the energy of 3p is smaller. So the most stable means that minimum energy. So most stable means minimum energy, right? Minimum energy. So this one have minimum energy, so that the energy of 3p will be smaller than the energy of 2p, and it will be smaller than the energy of 1p. All right. So basically, the energies of these levels have the minimum energy, which has the maximum L number, okay? Maximum L, maximum 2s plus 1, or multiple multiple term. So the multiple term, the spectral term, which is the maximum multiple term, has minimum energy. Also, suppose that we have the same number of multiple term, but we have different L values. So the one which has smallest angular momentum quantum number will have the minimum energy. So the energy of 3p 3p will be okay. Suppose that we have, let's check this in here because it's getting more and more complicated when we put everything on the top of each other. Suppose that we have these kind of energy levels. One is 3p and the other is 3s and the other one is 3d. Okay, so we know that for this p, s l equals 0 and d p l equals 1 and for this one l equals 2, right? We know that because it was given. Okay, so in this case, which one has the which one has minimum energy? Which one has minimum energy? Is it multiple term? Multiple term is the same for all these three, right? Multiple term is the same. So whichever has the maximum angular momentum will give will have the minimum energy level. So that in this case. The minimum the one which has the minimum angular momentum number will have the smallest energy. In this case, 3p, 3s. So e the energy of 3d will be the minimum, and the second one will be this one, the energy of 3p, and the last one, which will be this, okay, E3s. So the energy of this level is greater than energy of that, although S is for L equals 2 and P is for L equals 1, but this one has greater energy than that one, but this one has the minimum amount of energy when L equals 2, although we have the maximum angular momentum. Quantum number, we have the minimum energy case. So this Hund's principle just gives us the distribution of these different energy levels. This is the reason that we have the distribution. Remember that last time we have shown some kind of energy distribution. So if you place the quantum numbers as 1, 2, 3, we don't put 0 because all the passages through 0, 4, 5, and so on. And S is just starting from here, okay, starting from here, S, okay, S, and P starting from now here, P, always we are shifting 1, P, okay, and then D shifting 1 and we start, okay, these numbers and so on, right? So we also have F, right? After D, we have F, and it goes like that. 6, okay, is S, P, D, and F, so on, right? It goes on like that. So basically, this one from S to S is the first energy level transition. So we have the next smaller energy is this one, and then it goes here, and then from this obviously you go down, and then here now you don't go down, but you have to go all the way back because the energy of 3D is great, it's smaller than the energy of 4P. So energy of 3D is smaller than energy of 4S. This 3D and 4S corresponds to different kind of spectral terms that we will see later. But after that, so these passages are possible. So as you see, it goes down here and then it goes there. And from this S, okay, from this S, we go all the way down to F, and then from F to D, P, and so on. All these energy levels will show us how these levels are distributed, okay, in the spectrometer spectroscopy notation. So according to these rules, let's now find out the spectral term of NS2. So we had seen this earlier. So I'm just removing everything and now starting to these spectral terms. So find, let's find as an example, spectral term of NS2. So two electrons and L equals zero because we have S and N is the quantum number. So this is shell number, right? Shell number or quantum number. So in this case, we know that when S, if we have S, it means that L equals zero because S corresponds to L, but there are two electrons and two electrons. So we have L1 equals zero and L2 equals zero because two electrons in the first orbit where L equals zero correspond, we have these zero angular momentum quantum numbers. So this is the lowest possible energy, by the way. So in this case, when L is zero, then ML1 is zero and ML2 is zero. A magnetic axial quantum number. So according to the Pauli's exclusion principle, MS1 should be 1/2 and MS2 should be minus 1/2. There can be two electrons in the same orbit provided that their spins are opposite. So that the total total magnetic angular momentum quantum number is just ML, sum of MLs, okay, which is zero. So that when it is zero, we have L, right? Because zero corresponds to L. But this L equals zero, by the way. So MS is the total spin because we have now two spins, plus and minus, of course, it will give you zero. Minus 1/2 plus 1/2 will give you zero. So that this will corresponds to S. So the multiple term, which is 2S plus 1 is given by, okay, just 2 times 0 plus 1, which is just 1. So we just keep this. And then J is nothing but L plus S, as we said before. But now L is 0, but S is 0. So this L is 0 and S is 0. 0 plus 0 gives you 0. So that now the last term is the subscript is 0 also. So now, since we have a spectral term S, this N, this S, okay, we will have spectral term, which is S. Why? Because L equals zero corresponds to S, right? Zero, because this is here, and one multiple term goes there. So the spectral term of N S squared is just given by 1 S zero. The reason that we have S is because when L equals zero, okay? Good. So what about now the spectral term of NP squared? Find spectral term of NP squared. So how do we do this? First of all, since we have P, it means that L is equal to 1. So there are two electrons, as you see, two electrons. This is what we see. Probably this is just the second subgroup in the when N equals 2. Remember that in the previous table. Anyway, we have two electrons because we have two there. And then P, when we have P, it means that L equals 1. So that since there are two electrons, each one of them will have 1. Angular momentum quantum number. And then in this case, since in this case L will be just the sum of L's, right? But in vector notation, since here we didn't have any vectors, we just add them up and we gave zero, but now you have to consider this a vector notation. So now two vectors, 1, 1. So again, you have to consider this stuff. The maximum configuration, L equals 1, L1 equals 1, and L2 equals 1, and the total L equals 2. So the minimum configuration, when one is up, the other is down, L1 equals 1, and L2 equals 1. Okay, of course, down. When you add them up, L equals zero. So this is minus one, by the way. All the ones which are downward is minus. When you add them up, you get zero. So you, since you have L equals zero, L equals two, then you should have L equals one. Obviously, it is this, right? So when you have this, and then place it like that so that the result is just one. Okay, one. So L1 equals one there, L1 equals one there, and then they are aligned such that the resulting vector is also the sum of the two. Of course, there is an angle between them, and this angle can easily be found. So we will have L equals 0, 1, 2 cases. L equals 0, 1, 2 cases. In this case, ML, since we have, let's do this analysis for L equals 2 first, okay? Now, since we found L equals 2, let's consider L equals 2 and see what kind of configuration we have. Since we have L1 equals 1 and L2 equals 1, ML going to be, okay, ML will be, okay, minus 1, and actually, ML will be 1, right? And L and the other ML, ML1 will be 1, and ML2 will be also 1. In this case, L equals ML1 plus ML2, and it will give you 2. This is the reason that we have 2, right? So in this case, L's and ML's are the same. So Pauli exclusion principle states that MS1 should be minus 1 half, and MS2 is plus 1 half, or plus 1 half and minus 1 half, because we cannot know. In this case, S equals MS1 plus MS2, which gives you just 0. So that 2S plus 1 is equal to 0, 1, because S equals 0, 2 times 0 is 0, plus 1 gives you just 1. So S, 2S plus, multiple term is 1. And then J, which is L plus S, which gives you 2 plus 0, which is just 2, right? In this case, we put D here, D, because L equals 2 corresponds to D. Remember that L equals 0, 1, 2, 3 corresponds to S, P, D, and F orbits, okay? So since we have L equals 2, we have D there, and then the multiple term is just 1, and the J value, which is to be written as a subscript, is going to be 2. So the first spectral term is given by this. The first spectral term due to L equals 2 is given by 1D2. Don't forget, the spectral term, one of the spectral terms of MP2 is 1D2. Okay? So this really tells you everything, this notation. L is 2. And since 2s plus 1 is equal to 1, put this to the other side, 2s equals 0, and then s equals 0. So this gives you s value, and this gives you j value, right? Because it's just l plus s, and then you can find out that this is just l value. So basically, this gives you everything you need. So when l equals 1, let's solve it. Okay, on the left side of this board, okay, when L equals 1, okay, now we know that ML1 plus ML2 should be 1. In order this to be the case, there is no way that these angular momentum quantum numbers to be discrete, to be 1 half or minus 1 half or so on. It can be only 0 and 1. The only possibility to have 1 is that one of them is 0, but the other is 1. So when you add them up, you get 1, right? Or ML1 is 1 and ML2 is 0. Doesn't matter which one is which, because we don't know. So don't forget, when L equals 1, okay, L1 will be 1 and L2 will also be 1. So for this one, ML1 will be 0 and ML2 will be 1 because ML changes from L, minus L to plus L and 0. Okay? It is possible that ML1 to be 1, right? But if you put also ML1 1, L is not going to be 1. This is the reason that one of them should be 0. And obviously, since we have also MS1 equals 1 half and MS2 is equals 1 half. Don't forget, we're not considering this is a vector. These are just magnets. So these are the properties of these two electrons. So so the fact that MLs are different satisfies Pauli's exclusion principle. What is that? Actually, Pauli's exclusion principle that if there are two electrons in the same orbit, all of their quantum numbers cannot be the same. At least one of them should be different. As you see, in this case, they have the same spins, but the angular momentum are different. Can you see that? So this is okay, basically. At least one quantum number should be different. Okay? So we have now S equals the total S, since MS1, 1 half and 1 half, is just 1 half plus 1 half, which is equal to 1. In this case, the multiple term, or the exponent, the reverse exponent, 2S plus 1, which is just 2 times 1 plus 1, gives you 3. And then J is L plus S, but now we have to consider this in vector notation. That's interesting. Why? Because L and J, L and S should be added as vectors, okay? So for this one, there are possibilities, of course. Why? Why? Because look what happens. Since J is the vector sum of L and S, right? And L is 1, by the way, because the sum of them is L equals 1, it's given, right? L, we know, and S is just 1, so that when they are they have values 1, so maximum configuration is that when you have exactly the same directions. So L equals 1 and S equals 1, so that J equals 2, okay? When they are in the same direction. When they are in opposite direction, okay, this is the maximum case. The minimum case, when they have opposite direction. So L equals 1 here, S equals 1 there, the sum of them is 0. So, okay, 1 minus 1, 0. If there is 0, if there is 2, then there should be J equals 1. Obviously, maybe this kind of configuration we have. S equals 1, L equals 1, and J equals 1. So basically, there are three options. So we had now L was 2, but now L is 1 in this case. L is 1. When L is 1, this thing is P. We have P. This L equals 1 corresponds to P. Now we have J, 0, 1, and 2. So we have 0 and 2S plus 1 is always 2S plus 1 is 3. And then another J, which is 1, 3P1 and 3P2. Okay? So now what happens is that when L equals 1, we have three levels possible. So this level, P3P0 and 3P1 and 3P2. Okay? Why did we end up with these three degeneracy? because there was there is some vectoral summation of these J Ln. This is LS coupling, by the way. Because of the LS coupling, we ended up with these three results. All right. When we remember that earlier we handled L equals 2, which gave us this. For L equals 1, we have these three levels. But what about L equals 0? What about L equals 0? So let's write this result. So this was when L equals 1 here. And then when L was 2, we had just 1d2. Okay, 1d2. Now we are solving L equals 0 case, the third possibility. Okay. When L equals 0, then since L equals ML1 plus ML2, there is no way, but they will, each one of them will be 0. There is no other option. So ML1 should be equal to 0, and ML2 should also be equal to 0, so that their sum is 0. Okay? Since we have L equals 0, okay, L equals 0, L1 should be equal to 1, and L2 should be equal to 1, okay, 1. Sorry, this is 0, right? Because when L equals 0, we have 0 case, not 1. So in this case, the total L equals 0, and total S, total L is 0. Okay, it's already given. Okay, already given. But what about the spin? The spin is the sum M of MS1 and MS2. So they can only be with different spins. So MS1 will be equal to 1/2, and MS2 will be equal to -1/2. There is no other way. So obviously this is okay, because they cannot have the same spins. In this case, two electrons will have exactly the same quantum numbers, which is against the Pauli's exclusion principle. So at least one quantum number should be different. In this case, of course, it should be either MS1 and MS2. So they are rotating in their own orbit in opposite directions, obviously. So this is also 0. So the sum of these MS's is 0. So that what we have now, the multiple term, which is 2S plus 1 will give you just 2S plus 1 will give you just 1. And then since L equals 0, J is equal to L plus S. This is also going to be 0 plus 1, which is 1. Okay. Sorry, S equals 0 and L equals 0. Sorry, L equals 0, 0 plus 0, which is just 0. So J is 0. Since we have L equals 0, this L equals 0 corresponds to S. Okay. S. And then we have J, which is 0, and then multiple term, which is 2S plus 1, 1. So we have this spectral term. So that when L equals 0, okay, we have spectral term 1S0. So we have seen the energy levels. Look what happens in sodium case. Now we are ready to analyze the spectroscopic results. We are a spectroscopy expert now. Look, I'm going to leave this here. Okay, all these things I'm removing. Now I'm drawing the energy levels of sodium. Okay, so the sodium energy level in spectroscopy is given by this axis. So this is the energy in electron volts, by the way. Electron volts. So the first one is 3s, okay, 3s, and it's at -5.13 electron volts. The other one is 3p, this is -5, -4, -4, -3. minus 2, minus 1, and so on. It goes on 0, right? So 0 means it's ionization case. So now 3, we have 3s and 3p, 3p, right? And this 3p is right there around this, so that we have two electrons, okay, two electrons. Why? Because we have 3p, remember that 3p, 3 halves and 2p, 2p, 3 halves and 2p, 1 half. So two electrons, we had solved this earlier. So we have two there, and this is 3p, by the way, which has two different levels. And then 4s, just one level after that, it's here. This is 4s, just one level. And then 3d, but now 3d is slightly above that. So 3d, like that, 2. And this corresponds to, okay, 3d is corresponding to two different levels. And then we have after that 4p here, 4p, and then 5s here, slightly greater than that, and then 4d here, slightly greater than. As you see, p is here, s is there, and 4d there. Okay, 4d, and then 4f, 2. So now, all these passages are possible. For instance, we can go to 4p from this level. We can go 4p, okay, directly, and then you can go 3p, and then 3p, because there are two possibilities like this. Let's draw it like that. And then 4p, there are two possibilities, okay, like that, two possibilities. And then from 3p to 4s, there is only one passage you can go. And from 4s, between 4s and 3p, but between 4s and 3p, okay, two different passages, which has two different degenerate cases. And 5s is again is one, but it goes down to 3p, but using two different paths. And so since 4p is given by this these two levels, now look what we have. So you can go from 3p to 3d, from 3p to 3d, like this, okay? And from 3d to 4f, like this, and then 4p to 4d, 4d, two of them, 4d, and from 4s to 4d, 4s to 4d, and so on. Remember that this kind of zigzag passages, okay, is all explained here. And sodium, remember that it was 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, and then 3s1. Okay. So don't forget, these are all spectral representation. So what we have seen is that these passages are shown by the spectral notation. All right, now let's go into Landi G factor, anomalous Zeeman effect. anomalous or strange, whatever, Zeeman effect is shown that there will be some kind of energy level degeneracies, but they will be not giving different, they will be given by different kind of degeneracies. For instance, the bottom one here in one of these electronic energy level in some atom, for instance, when D is zero, we have these kind of energy levels, let's say. But when there is B, when magnetic field is applied, this first energy level will be just degenerate into two energy levels, not the one in the middle. In here also, these will just degenerate to only two energy levels, okay, like this. But this other one will degenerate into four energy levels, like this. Here, of course, these will be symmetric, so you can just put them down like that. So basically, this is kind of strange. So each one of these energy levels just split into different energy levels and different structures. So this, how can we explain this? So in order to understand this, first, let's write the magnetic moment of the electron as a vector. It's given by, for some factor GL times mu B Bohr magneton divided by H bar times LI as a vector, plus the sum, of course, this is minus, again, minus GSI, times the Bohr magneton divided by H bar times SI vector. So this is due to just the magnetic moment of the total electrons in an orbit. Of course, the number of electrons change the values of L and S, and Bohr magneton and H bar are constants, but these are Lambda G factors. So this G are called Lambda G factors. This is a very important factor, by the way. So how can we find this Lambda G factor? By the way, let's draw again. So if this is the magnetic field that we apply, we have J here, J vector, which is total angular momentum. And this J vector rotates around, the total angular momentum vector rotates around the magnetic field like that. But L and S rotate around the J vector. So if L is this way, rotating on a cone like this, and S will be rotating like this on another cone, maybe at a slight greater radius. So now, if you just continue from here, these are all new. So if you continue here, this will give you exactly the same direction, and it's mu L, because L and mu L are in different directions because of these minus signs, as you will remember. Mu L is there, but since this is S, mu S is this way, mu S is this way, but the vectorial sum of that is just giving you mu J. Everything works fine, as you see. This mu J happens to be in the opposite direction to J. So now, when you introduce the magnetic field, the total angular momentum vector just starts to rotate around the magnetic field, and L and S vectors rotate around the J vector. And then because of this rotation, we have all these different kind of structures. So when we can analyze this one, that one, and that one, we can really understand the energy change and also the torque applied. Of course, there is a precision motion because of the rotation plane changes and so on. So we will have now the total mu J, as you see from here, the total angular momentum magnetic moment, total magnetic moment is given by mu L and mu S, the sum of mu L and mu S in vector notation, obviously. So the angle between them is important because If we have, as you see here, suppose that this is mu j, if we just look at this triangle, mu j, put mu j here, and then say that this is mu l. Okay, suppose that, okay, wait a minute. When we have, when we have mu j, which is mu times cosine, okay, the angle between mu and j, okay, whatever mu we are considering. If we say mu s, suppose that this is just the notation, mu times, okay, cosine, mu and j, okay, mu and j. So what's happening is that from these two, we can see that mu s will be equal to mu times mu dot j, okay, divided by mu j magnitude. Why? This is just the cosine theta. Because remember that you have mu s here, mu j there, j, and suppose this is mu, and then we have this kind of rotation, okay? Then mu s equals mu times cosine theta, but mu j equals mu times cosine alpha, if this is theta and this alpha. Of course, the summation of alpha and theta is 90 degrees. So this is the notation that we have. We also know that mu L is equal to minus Bohr magneton times L, according to Bohr's theory, and mu S equals minus 2S, 2 Bohr magneton times S vector. So these are the vectors we have. In this case, mu J, okay, will be equal to mu L plus mu S. Okay, just add them up. So when we add them up, okay, when we add them up, mu j will give you, okay, will give you just mu times, because of this, mu times cosine theta, okay? Mu j is this. In this case, now, since from this we can get mu j, which is just sum of them, it's just minus mu b, which is Bohr magneton, times L plus 2s. L plus 2s. Remember L plus 2s we have here. Okay, so basically what happens is that so this mu and times cosine theta is given by that. Mu j is just simply minus Bohr magneton divided by J times L plus 2S, which is just mu J, and then L plus S. Okay, L plus S. So when we have this, we can just multiply these two parentheses. We see that minus MB mu B over J times L squared, because L times L, maybe there is a dot, yeah, there should be a dot here. So L dot L gives you L squared, and these two gives you 2S squared. And then, of course, we have the other opposite products, L dot S and 2LS, so it will be 3LS, so plus 3 L dot S vectors. So we have this configuration. Since, okay, now let's continue. Since we have J equals L plus S, J dot J will give you J squared. We have J there, remember? Which is just L squared plus S squared plus 2 L dot S, obviously. The square of these two vectors, dot product, right? Gives you this one. And then J squared is this. Also 3LS, because we have 3LS here, we multiply L and S, and then it is equal to 3J squared minus 3L squared minus 3S squared divided by 2, basically. Okay? So from this, remember that we had this 3LS squared. If you look at the product of these, now let's check this product of these mu j. Also, not only is it equal to that, but also this can be written as, okay, mu l, in this case, let's get mu l, but mu l is minus Bohr magneton divided by j, just like here, okay, l squared plus 2s squared plus 3LS, but 3LS is given by this. So let's write 3LS here plus 3J squared minus 3S squared minus 3L squared, everything divided by 2. Okay, close the parentheses. And then mu J, okay, mu L is given by this. So mu J will be equal to minus Bohr magneton divided by J minus L square plus S square plus 3J square divided by 2. Okay, in this case mu J B, or just the projection of mu J onto the magnetic axis, is mu zero times cosine theta, which is minus mu, sorry, not zero, but we just use mu for this one, J dot B divided by J B. Okay, this is how you define the angle, by the way, because the angle, suppose that you have vectors, two vectors, you multiply, and it's just A times B times cosine theta. If you put this to the other side, cosine theta is just A dot B divided by AB, right? This is how you get the angles between the two, the angle between the two vectors. So now, when we have this, in this case, let's look at this delta E business. Delta E then will be, remember, minus mu dot magnetic field, okay? The total magnetic moment times the magnetic field. In this case, delta E will be given by Bohr magneton divided by 2J squared, J and another J coming from here, J squared times minus L squared plus S squared plus 3J squared, okay, times B, the magnetic field, times MJ, okay, MJ. So from this, if you just keep following this analysis, you see that delta E, by the way, will be given by Bohr magneton times G times B times MJ. So the energy change will be given by this. And this lambda G factor, or just GL or G, is lambda G factor. And it is given by this analysis gives you all these vectorial representation. The lambda G factor is given by just 1 plus J squared, okay, plus S squared minus L squared over 2J squared, right? This is according to Bohr's theory. According to Bohr's theory. But according to wave mechanics, GL is similar to that, but instead of these squares, we use J plus 1, S plus 1, and L plus 1, as I told you earlier. So instead of J squared, we write J plus 1, plus S plus 1 minus L plus 1, okay, divided by 2J plus 1. This is degeneracy formula. So in this case, when we have this, this is called lambda G factor. Okay, so mu J mu j will be given as minus Bohr magneton times lambda g, okay, square root of j j plus 1. So this is the angular momentum, magnetic angular magnetic moment, and this is total angular moment. This is angular momentum, okay, angular moment is minus mu v times g square root of l l plus 1, and spin magnetic moment is given by minus Bohr magneton times g square root of s plus 1. So as you see, we have exactly the same expressions, except that these are the new terms that multiply these values. Okay, so how can we really understand what's going on? So as a result, g is different when s is not equal to zero, but when s equals zero, do you know what happens when s equals zero? Then everything goes away, right? When s equals zero, s plus one is zero, but j is just l plus one, and there is also another l plus one. They cancel each other, and then gl becomes one. So gl is just one. So it means that it doesn't affect the calculations. In this case, delta e, which is just given by minus mu b, the Bohr magneton times the magnetic field times mj, just and there is g. Of course, remember that we introduced g there, and this is one, so that this will be just minus Bohr magneton times bmg j. So this is the same result that we found for s equals zero. But when s is different than zero, then these g is different for others. Okay, let's see what happens. Now, let's find out the degeneracies of these different spectral terms. For instance, let's find anomalous, okay, Zeeman effect, Zeeman split of spectral term 2s1/2. Okay, find that 2s1/2. Now, when we have s, it means that j equals, since this is j equals 1/2, because this is j, and 2s plus 1 is 2, so that s should be 1, right? There is no other way. S should be 1. Okay, so 2s equals 1, s equals 1, right? If you put this to the other side, you get 2s equals 1 and s equals 1/2, right? S equals 1/2. Basically, we find that j equals 1/2 and s equals 1/2. Since we have s here, it means that total L is zero. MJ, what about MJ? MJ, which goes to, which changes from minus J to zero and then plus J. In this case, we see that MJ is not equal to zero, so that it can be MJ's, one of the MJ should be minus 1/2. The other MJ should be 1/2, okay? So two electrons will have different kind of total angular momentum. All right, so what is G? G is equal to 1 plus J plus 1. Don't forget, let's write this G factor is given here. 1 plus J plus 1. But j plus 1 plus s plus 1, let's write it down, minus l plus 1. everything divided by just 2j, j plus 1. Okay? So now, since we have L equals 0, L equals 0, when L equals 0, see, in this case, this term goes away, and J is just S, J will be equal to S, so that we have two of them, which gives you 1 plus 2J, J plus 1, and divided by two, another 2J, J plus 1, they will cancel each other, and then we get just 2, right? 1 plus 1 will give you just 2. So G will be 2. So there is this energy level, this energy level is split into two levels, because GL was 2. GL is 2. So the split will be, if we have E0, it will be E0, okay, plus 1 half H bar, and this will be giving you minus E0 minus 1 over 2 H bar. Because delta E will be just delta E, which is just given by that, Bohr magneton times mj, but mj, remember, 1 half, and g is either, if g is 2, then mu b mj, but mj is equal to 1 half, so b, right? Actually, this is Bohr magneton. Let's say that this is Bohr magneton, right? Mb. And the other one will be minus Bohr magneton times B. So that the difference between the two is just 2, right? So this delta E will give you 2. So we have seen that this energy level belonging to this spectral term is split into two energy levels like that. What about 2P12? Let's check 2P12. Zeeman anomalous, Zeeman split, okay, Zeeman split of spectral term given by 2p one half, 2p one half now, 2p one half. So for 2p one half, since we have p, it means L equals 1. Okay, since this is one half, J equals 1 half, and 2s plus 1 is 2, which means that s equals 1 half. J equals 1 half means that we have mj, which is minus 1 half, and mj, which is plus 1 half. There is no other possibility. We cannot have 0 when mj is not integer, or j is not integer. We can never have 0 there. So we have S equals 1 half, we have L equals 1, we have J values, and then MJ, everything. In this case, J times J plus 1 is 1 half times 1 half plus 1, which is 3 quarters. And then S plus 1 is equal to 1 half times 1 half plus 1, which gives you, again, 3 quarters. And then L plus 1 gives you, since L equals 1, 1 plus 2 is just 2. So we have all these values. So Landi G factor is just, okay, 1 plus 3 over 4 plus 3 over 4, remember, minus 2, okay, everything divided by 3 halves. Because J plus 1 is 3 quarters, and if you multiply by 2, because there is 2 on the denominator, it becomes 3 halves, basically. So it gives you 1 plus 3 halves, okay, minus 2, because this is 3 halves divided by 3 halves, again. And then this is 1 minus 1 over 3, which is just 2 over 3, okay? So now, MJ, remember that was minus 1, 2, and 1 over 2. In this case, MJG will be just minus, since G is 2 thirds, minus 1 third and 1 third. In this case, the energy will split into two pieces again. Energy will split into two pieces. Okay, where we will have E zero, okay, plus one third, mu B, and then E zero minus one third Bohr magneton times B, right? Just like here. So these two energy levels, corresponding to the spectral terms 2p 1 half, is going to split into two pieces like this. There will be no E0, by the way, because everything is like not integers, but real, like multiples of 1 half, 3 half, 3, and so on. But the spectral term split into these two levels. 1 over 2, as you see, these coefficients are different, not exactly the same, depending on this Lambda G factor. So all you have to do is just memorize this Lambda G factor. You are not responsible from the derivation of this, which is tedious algebra, as you have seen earlier. But if you just remember this, you can really find out the split in the energy. Now let's look at another energy level split, which will give us four different levels. Okay, now find the anomalous Zeeman split of this spectral term. Okay, which one is this? It's just 2p 3 halves. Okay, 2p 3 halves. Here, since we have J there, J equals 3 halves, as you see. In this case, when we have J, MJ will change from minus 3 halves, minus 1 half, 1 half, and 3 halves. There will be no zero because this is not integer. Don't forget, when J is not integer, MJ cannot assume zero value. And this is the multiple term, which is 2. So 2s plus 1 is equal to 2 because of this. This is because of that. And then when it is 2, from here, we can see that s equals 1 half. When we have p, p means that l equals 1. Okay? So now, g, which is 1 plus, now, s plus 1, okay, which is j plus 1, okay, which is 3 halves times 3 halves plus 1, minus l plus 1, but l was 1, so 1 plus 1, minus s plus 1, but it's 1 half, minus 1 half, 1 half plus 1. Okay, this is j, l, and s. Divided by 2 times, okay, 2 times j plus 1, but j was 3 half, so 3 over 2 times 3 over 2 plus 1. As you see, this is just nothing. Very simple algebra. These two cancel each other and so on. So when you have this, g will be given by just 1 plus 15 over 4, okay, plus 3 over 4 minus 2, everything divided by 15 over 2, okay, and then it will just give you just this equal to 1 plus, okay, 18 over 4 minus 2 divided by 15 over 2, which is just 1 plus 10 over 30. So if you just check this out, And then it will give just 1 plus 1, 1 over 3, which is just 4 over 3. So MJ G will have 4 values, which are just 4 over 3 times minus 3 halves, minus 1 half, 1 half, and 3 halves. So now MG G will be just these 3 cancel, and then 2 divided by 2 is just minus 2, and then minus 2 over 3. Now it's strange, one of them is integer, the other is not integer, and then obviously 2 over 3 and then 2, right? So now delta E, so there will be split in the energy levels. Whatever the energy level is, there will be 4 different energy split, and one of them will be E0 plus 2 over 3 Bohr magneton times B. This will be E0 plus 2 Bohr magneton times B. Obviously, these coefficients are, if this was twice as much as that, it would have been 4 over 3, and then the energy split would be exactly with the same distance, but now this distance is greater than the other one. So now this is E0 minus 2 over 3 Bohr magneton B, and then this is E0 plus minus 2 Bohr magneton times B. So now let's draw what we have obtained. What we have obtained, okay? So now if we have these spectral levels like this, suppose we have 2s 1 half, and then we have 2p 1 half, and then of course 2p 3 halves. According to the rules, 3p 2p 3 halves is actually having more energy than this one, and this will have more energy than that one. So we have these kind of rules. Okay? Hund rule. Hund rules. Just remember the Hund rule. So basically, suppose that in any kind of atomic energy structure, we have this kind of energy levels possible. Doesn't matter which atom it is, but this is when B equals zero. But when B is applied, if B is applied, then this energy level and these energy level and this energy level, they will all be split into pieces. For S 1 half, we see that it's just we have now split plus 1 half and minus 1 half. Okay, so it means that 1 half times, so this energy difference is 1 half times Bohr magneton times B. So whatever energy of that is, we have this kind of energy split. Okay. Now the other one will be plus 1 half and minus 1 half, but the difference between the energy levels will be just not exactly the same. Okay, let's draw this a little bit closer to these orbits, to these levels, actually. So this is plus 1 half and this is minus 1 half. Here, also we have exactly for this 2p 1 half case, we have now 1 third of this, right? 1 third of that, very small. So we have now, and then the other one is 2 thirds. So this was 1. Remember, lambda g factor was just 1. And then here, lambda g factor was 1 third. Okay. So in this case, the split in the energy levels will be closer to this original energy levels. So this will correspond to this will correspond to, okay, just plus 1 half. Oh, this is plus 1, plus 1 and minus 1, plus 1 half and minus 1 half. And the other one, which we just found, Landeji factors were 2, 2, 3, 2, 3, with a minus sign and minus 2 and so on. So that, as you see, if 2 thirds is here somewhere, okay, 2 is, minus 2 is right there. So this is for minus 2 thirds, this is due to 2, minus 2. And this is obviously 2 thirds there, and this is just minus 2. So this will be far away. Okay. These two will be far away. Okay. So these distances will not be the same, obviously. So this is plus 2. So there will be degeneracies, as you see. Now, this is, again, for this one, 1/3. This is minus 1/3. So let's remove these numbers. So Landeji factors are written. So here, plus 1 and minus 1. If 1/3 is this one, 1 is this much. So this is plus 1 and this is minus 1. As you see, these distances show you the levels of the energy change, but also the Landeji factors just show you how thick these energy split will be. Okay? So for this one, the total energy split is this much. For this one is this much, as you see, and for this one is that much. So they are different for all different energy levels. This is called not normal or just abnormal or just anomalous Zeeman effect. In order to understand this split, you have to go to Landeji factor. Okay, so we learned not only spectral terms, but also the split, normal Zeeman split or anomalous Zeeman split. And we learned why these splits may be different for different spectral terms due to this Landeji factor. And it gives us excellent results for the spectroscopy. And this is the end of today's lecture, and I hope that you enjoyed again. It was a little bit complicated, but please do not pay attention how G is derived. At least you derive once and you forget, but you have to remember this formula, okay? In this case, you can be really expert in spectroscopy later on if you take some high-level courses. So this is the end of lecture, so I'm just stopping the recording.